session. I'm very surprised that so many people are here coming to this topic. I try to give my best here. I have got 6 different devices connected through Bluetooth to Wi-Fi, running on 5 different operating systems, connecting to 3 different cloud systems in the backend. So nothing could go wrong here. So everything, I have prepared all the sessions as video demos, but I try to do everything live. Welcome to the world of the Internet of Things. So everyone on the keynote this morning? Yes. Yeah, something to just to wake you up. Do you know this one here? Just to get a little up here in the morning a little. Who got the message with the password? Okay, we got it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we want to have a secure password use this. Okay, but now for something completely different. This is a session Office 365 and the Internet of Things. Welcome to the session. I hope I can get you a nice little insight how the Internet of Things will maybe change the way we work with our devices within the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years. And I will try to give you an insight. I've brought with me some sensors, some nice technology. We're streaming the session live on Facebook Live with this nice camera there on the right area. And yeah, it's not really about SharePoint. It's not really about Office 365, but it's about how to connect the real world to the digital world. It's in a state maybe 1.0, what you can do currently, but it's developing so fast. And get ideas and inspiration for your own business. This is what I want to do with this session. So, first of all, my name is Michael Greth. I'm a SharePoint MVP for 19 years right now. Started with FrontPage. Anybody knows FrontPage? Raise your hands.
Yeah.
Good time. So I founded the SharePoint community in Germany in 2001. So I get the insight in the first alpha version of SharePoint. And I'm working as a consultant, doing podcasts for 12 years right now, doing some other stuff on the websites. And I'm focused on, see how we can use the technology. And as I look back, the whole SharePoint platform, now with Office 365, has evolved so, it's such a big thing right now. You can do so many things with that. That's my target. Okay. The Avenger, it's very smart. First, I want to talk about what is IoT, what does it mean? Then we will dig into some hardware stuff. I brought some devices here. Then I will show you some software which is taken to connect these hardware devices to the cloud. And then we will go to the question, say, hey, what has it to do with Office 365? Is it nice technology, but what does it have to do with me? And demos. Okay, I have lots of demos here and I hope it will work. Okay, who has already done something with IoT? Just again, okay. And who has no idea what IoT is? Okay, some sort of IoT. Okay, first of all, the Internet of Things. I got this definition here from Gartner. Gartner is always a good thing to get some definitions. The Internet of Things is a network of physical objects that contain embedded technology, such as intelligent sensors, which can communicate, sense, or interact with internal or external systems. So these are tools. Try it now. Okay, let's stop the. I've tried to prepare it here on that one. And if it works like expected, I should be able to. Let me see. So there you see this small device. This is a temperature sensor, and it can sense temperature and can send this temperature to any device. And this is, where is it? And all these devices you use as the IoT device are such models. There's lots of other sensors. I'll show you some others a little bit later. And these and these sensors taking real life data and put it into the cloud services. And these sensors generate volumes of real-time data, and with all the real-time data you can do analytics, whatever. And some areas where these sensors are used are in the industry. So to monitor how a machine is working, if it's working within its limits, or is maybe it's some defects that are approaching. You see it in the topic of predictive analytics. So maybe if you have elevators and you put in sensors, you can predict if this elevator will fail maybe 2 or 3 weeks ahead, and then you can send a technician out before the elevator fails. So this is the technical stuff, and IoT is therefore is nothing new. Industry has sensors or whatever built in this in their machines for decades. But what's new is that now we have common backends, common platforms where you can go interact with these old sensors on a common platform. And not all manufacturer has its own platform where it's using the sensors. But IoT, when I started with IoT, when I did this session first 1.5 years ago, and I thought IoT was very important for us. But over the last year, so many new technologies have come that I can say IoT is just one piece. But you see more and more cognitive services. You have already heard about Azure, cognitive services, machine learning, getting all this data, do predictive analytics of that one, doing speech recognition, and more. All these services are implemented in the cloud right now and are available through APIs and through public services to use it in your environment, in your applications. Another one is coming up, bots. Has already been used bots in the business life? Facebook bots or Skype bots? These are machine agents that are implemented into maybe into your messenger, and you interact with them like a real person. And based on your questions, it will give you answers automatically by maybe predicting what you're expecting. I will show you another bot later on. I will go to the slides with some explanation. Afterwards, we'll go to some demos. And has everyone tried the HoloLens already? Virtual reality is another one where you can get rid of monitors and whatever, just put on your glasses and you have a complete different view of the reality through virtual reality and whatever. So all these is not really IoT, but all these technologies will affect the way we are using technology within the next years. You know, when we started, we have keyboards, monitors. This was version one. The next version was smartphones, where you do everything with touch. And now, in the next version, maybe we don't have to touch anywhere. We communicate through speech or whatever. And to give you a demonstration, maybe I tried it with work. Alexa, Lautstärke 10. Now I'm communicating with this device here. It's the Alexa Echo Dot, and it's based completely on voice recognition. So I can say, Alexa, wie spät ist es? Alexa, wie spät ist es? Depends on the Wi-Fi. Alexa, wie spät ist es?
Die Zeit ist 10:26.
Geht doch, so 10:26 ist okay. Alexa, wer ist der Präsident der Vereinigten Staaten?
Der amtierende Präsident der Vereinigten Staaten ist Barack Obama. Sein Nachfolger wird Donald Trump.
Alexa, was ist der Sinn des Lebens?
Sinn des 42, aber vergiss dein Handtuch nicht.
42, don't miss your towel. Alexa, Lautstärke 1. So, this is the next generation of devices. I'm communicating with this device just here, just standing there, just asking questions, doing, sending commands out there. Nothing to touch anything more. This is a version 1.0. You can do something with that. It says... It's a little bit... It's 1.0.
Artificial intelligence. Oh, no.
I wish we know the commands. That's the Java version. But it's very interesting. I got it 3 weeks ago. And I was very skeptical about it. But definitely that's the next version. You can put it, it's here, but I can put it anywhere in the corner. And even if I'm standing there at the door and I ask Alexa do this, I can ask her questions. I can, in Berlin, we have, I'm from Berlin, and we have implemented a skill here that we kind of, when does the next bus go from my next bus stop? And they can tell it me. So everything's automatically, no touch, no keyboard, nothing anymore. And I think within, and even if you have Siri or Cortana, you know, always need some kind of these devices here.
She speaks other languages?
Yeah. This is in German, but normally it's very, it's much better in English. Okay. And there's one point I will show you later where I wish they have already implemented in Germany.
Okay.
But this would be a device, it's something that it listens all the time, mm-hmm. which maybe is a little bit spooky, that you have this little mouse point here, permanently listening, what you're doing, what you're saying. And there's a button where you can say quiet, and she, the dog is not listening anymore. Hopefully, I'm not sure. But this is the next generation of user interface. Yeah. And it's astonishingly good, voice recognition without any training for these simple commands. And so this is something what I will say. It's not only about sensors, but about all the technologies that coming up, VR, cognitive services, bots and whatever, it will completely change the way we work with technology within the next 5 years. And when you remember 2007, we had no iPhone. And when you look now at what we are using, smartphones today, and how dramatically they have changed the way we are working, predict what maybe in 2020, if not 10 years ahead, maybe 5 years ahead, and there will dramatically change. So this is just to give you an insight, and the market for IoT is very big, presumably big, and currently has all different areas for home automation, security systems to turn your light on or to lower your blinds when you're on vacation or whatever, can do that on factories for all the monitoring from machines, retail. You know, I fear we show later an RFID tag which scans automatically the device, the goods you are selling. Human health, who has a Fitbit or an Apple Watch tracking his health parameter? Not so many here, right? Who has a band? Okay. Who's satisfied? Okay. Then we have tracking logistics, container tracking, still very popular to track containers with sensors and whatever. Cities, public services, tons of ideas there what can be implemented in public services. And of course, cars. Who drives a Tesla? Filled up with sensors, driving autonomously, supervision there. So this all is normally what said, okay, this is my private life, this is industry, this is whatever. But even in our daily work life, what we call collaboration, in the new workplace, these technologies will affect how we work with this technology. And here are the topics, touchless, sensor-driven, cognitive services, and speech, at some points. So, let's go into some details about the hardware. First of all, you already own a wonderful IoT device. This is your wonderful IoT device. This is an absolute prototype of an IoT device because this smartphone, your smartphone, is full of sensors. So the GPS sensors, It has accelerator, the light sensor, microphone, camera, fingerprint sensor, Bluetooth, NFC, Fitbit, depending on what kind of device you have. Maybe you have something that can explode if you have a Samsung Note 7, but everything's fine. And all these sensors get data from the real world and put it into your smartphone. And with this data, your smartphone and the apps on your smartphone can provide services. Maybe you can take a picture, you can take a video, you can navigate, because through Wi-Fi and through GPS, it knows where you're located, and it has a map and can send you to the right direction. It can provide location-based services. So if you have maybe, we'll see later, such a kind of a beacon, you can recognize locations, your smartphone can recognize that is a beacon, maybe it's another McDonald's, and when you enter it, it sends you a coupon on your smartphone and says, hey, Big Mac today, €1 cheaper if you just call the code 145 or whatever. Monitoring health, payment, authentication, all these services can be provided through this device based on the IoT stuff, on the sensors there. So it's always a kind of sensors getting the reality, software and apps doing some stuff with that, and then the outcome providing services. And so the IoT, the smartphone is definitely one of the best examples for an IoT device. Maybe you're not aware of it, but it has dramatically changed how the way you're working with the phone over the last years. If you think about it, and how you're doing stuff, and when you're walking around in Vienna, I'm looking at, okay, where can I go here? Please navigate me. So everything's done by this one. This is how this IoT stuff is coming into our daily life without the big baba, but with small, with on cat feet, very, very slowly and very, very quiet. Okay. Some of the basic IoT devices which are used in daily life, I've done another screenshot here. Because it's something. This is a temperature sensor I already showed you. It's a smaller temperature sensor. This is an ultrasonic sensor to measure distances. This is an RFID chip reader where you can maybe read this text here on your sweater. Light sensor, and there are smaller ones, a color sensor and a BP108 sensor. It senses 108. No, it's a temperature sensor. And then we have, if you want to start with IoT, it's very easy because these sensors are very cheap. I think this one I got directly from China. You can order it through eBay for €2.50, take 6 weeks, and you get a small orange bag with just this one single item in it. Delivered from China for €2.20. It's fascinating how the world is working today. There are some other stuff. And like this one here, that's blinking here. This is a kind of, this is called the circuit playground. And if you want to start with it, it's very cheap. It costs about €20. But it has complete sensors on board. It has 10 neopixels for all the lighting. And as you see, it has a sound sensor. So it's a kind of light organ here. It has touch capabilities. So when I touch here, the things on the outer side, it is connected to, can you see, you can't see behind, sorry. My cable is too long, but I can't switch it. It took me years to get this set up, but that's fine, shouldn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, I have a cable problem. Sorry about that, the cable is too long. But if you want to see it later, I can show it. And it has, it has a sound sensor on it. It has an accelerator that, so when I move it, and it's connected to the LEDs here, the light color changes. This is a very easy device. It's programmed through the basic Arduino IDE, which is standard for doing stuff on this platform here. And it has a temperature sensor on it, so you can use it as a starting point to do something with that. And what we find out in the IoT business is when you want to start to do something with IoT. Or maybe I want to use a sensor, maybe for temperature, for location. I wanted to implement it in my software. You have to start to solder all this stuff together, but these boards make it very easy to do that. And this is another one. This is from Texas Instrument. And okay, let's go directly to the demo. I think it's more fun to go demo. I just have to switch on my iPad. Let's see where it is. And this is also a board which provides services with different sensors. So let's see. Going back to where is it? Where are you? MBJ. Yes. This is an app running on my iPad, scanning all the Bluetooth devices that are active here in the room. So these are all your smartphones scanning here. And maybe if you have a security breach, I can click here and say, wow, let's see, does this sensor provide any information for me? Click here on sensor view, and it will say, no, this device has no front end MacBook. But it says me, OK, is it serial number? Well, this provides no special information, but it scans all the devices here and recognize if there are sensors connected here on in this area. So that makes me a little bit, well, no, there it is. So, but this button is connected, this device is connected through Bluetooth. And when I open it, it recognizes all things. This device, it's a train device, it has two buttons. You see, when I click here on this one, it has two buttons. And it has a temperature sensor. I can go on the temperature device, show that. And it shows the temperature here in the room. I am dead. It wasn't the outcome of the session I expected, but maybe. okay, I'm still alive. Great. So this can collect data, and maybe the easiest way here is a button where I can click on and can save all the temperature data, just as maybe in a CSV file, send it to Power BI, and then do a dashboard where it shows the temperature that has been in my room for the last 15 minutes or whatever. So this is a very easy way to connect it maybe through Bluetooth, to Power BI. And there's another one that I really want to show you because it can track the movements. You see here, when I move it up and down, and it has a wonderful, nice, that's what I want to show you, a wonderful, nice, come on. So if you can really turn it on, turn it off. Show you how it looks. You can click one here, it can open it up. You can open up a second time. And then you see, and I can click. You see, it's really so hard. So you can see inside, and it's just tracking. So it's not a big thing to connect these devices, and on the other hand, it can already interact from my what I've done so far was just clicking here and getting information into the app, but I can do it on the other way around. It has a red LED light, and I can switch it on. You see here the red light, the green light, and it has a buzzer. So this is also a device where you can start to do some stuff with that, and you don't have to assemble your IoT device just to get data into your thing. Very easy stuff, very well documented, and on the other hand, always creepy to do, to work with it. You're always astonished what can be done. So this was the So just to give you an idea, but there are tons and tons of stuff more, and there's a whole big community worldwide. It's called the Maker Movement, that are using this stuff and building tons of wonderful tools and devices for very low prices. And this is something what makes this technology so important right now, because all these devices have gone down in the price, and maybe this one costs maybe 50 cents, this one costs 3 euros, even this one with 22 is a little bit higher price, but it's very cheap to get all this stuff. This is, so this was the sensors. I dropped this one, I showed it. The next one, and then we go on one of the first demos, is the RFID and NFC chip, the RFID technology. You find it in department stores where your clothes are tagged with these to protect you from robbery. And this is one, you can have it on a plastic card. And it all includes such a antenna here based on copper and a little chip. And on this chip, you can save maybe 120, 140 characters. So does it more. And when you're approaching an RFID reader, it's a passive device, has no battery. But when you're approaching an RFID reader, it gets contact and sends the information back to the device you're coming with. And as I will do all my demos live, we will skip for the first demo. We're going to the first demo, okay. I do it right now to show you how this NFC tag works in real life. Okay. So therefore, I'm using my Windows Phone. If you have a Windows Phone, normally Windows Phone supports these RFID tags. You have an option to turn on the NFC option. And with NFC, you can read tools like that. And I have turned it on here. And when I put this tag on my phone, it recognized that there is an action on this thing here. And the action I programmed here is open up a web page with this URL I've coded here. And when I click it, opens up my browser, and I click accept. And then it triggers an event. And the event, if you see here, in my Teams site, it clicks up and says new news. And when I go to see what's news, here, you see, it sends this one, I call the doorbell conference room, and it sent me an information directly in my Teams site. So
it has no battery.
It has no battery.
And where the energy comes
from? It's just from the NFC reader here. It sends some energy out, and it's through the antenna. It sends only back this one. It's not battery power, but it just goes through inductivity.
Yeah.
So this is so I connect this fancy little tool through my Windows Phone with my Teams site, and when it's ready, it should open up new news. And you see, it's here. No big deal. I will show you later when I go to the backend how we do it with software, how it's done. Yeah. So this is one simple thing you can see, and this is for me. I have to say, I'm not a programmer. I'm one of these who has ever worked with a SharePoint designer. I'm one of these SharePoint designers. It's no code solution. That's one of my favorite. And I think everything I will show you today is just done by no-code solutions, just taking this what's there and using the platform. And even this one, and you know, we had the call for papers for this conference was in March. So I submitted this one, and this demo was done last week because Teams is up there for 2 weeks already, not longer. So I had to rewrite my demo and said, okay, why not take Teams? And you see, it fits, it works. So this is just, please, these are not real life examples. It's a proof of concept that show you what you can do. Maybe you have your doorbell or whatever you can do with it. So, but no problem to connect an RFID chip with your team site and through a secure way. That must be a hit. Another one, and we skip it again. Another one, what I show you is, where is it? Let me see. Sorry about switching all the demos here, but this is a little bit down here. Okay, this is another one. So this is these are the RFID stuff. All readers integrated with one. This is a beacon. I will show you what the beacon can do a little bit later. And this is another tool from Amazon. Is someone using this? The dash button? Who is the dash button at home? You know the dash button? This is the Every Zweck Form button. It costs $4.99. I can put it on my printer in my office, and whenever the paper is empty, I just press the button and order a new box of paper from Amazon, and 2 days later, the box is there. Theoretically. In real life, it's damn expensive to buy this specific box of paper for this. Through this button, the price of the paper is much higher than I go to my local store and buy it. But it's nice technology and it works. just another thing. It's the same. It's for detergents, for your washing machine, where when you're off of maybe Persil or whatever, you just press the button and Amazon is directly delivering service from me. It's just a simple Wi-Fi connected button, IoT device. And I have here this little one, it's a flick button, it was a Kickstarter project, and this flick button, I'm sure that I can take this giant thing, so drop it here, it works on an app, it needs an app to work, and this app runs on the iPhone. So this is the app running on the iPhone. And for the flicking, you can define three different states here. One press, double click, and hold. And each of these three states can be connected to different services. There are tons of services you can connect in the backend. Maybe you can Slack, Spotify, whatever, and can do trigger something. And there is something new. I will show you what I'm using here. It's called the webhook, the internet request, and I programmed it. And for a double click, I programmed, when I double click, please call this URL. It's an Office 365 URL, and send this body text. Someone is at the door in room 232. Send this one. So when I double click, let me see where is the. Go back to the team site. And when I double click it now, new news. And someone is a dog. This could be a really good doorbell. And get from there. And it already can use this as a little sticker where I can put it here on my back and can maybe start my. Normally it's done for maybe. Start my music, stop my whatever, but you can connect it to Office 365. Simple button powered through, but it needs the device here. So it needs to be connected to a smartphone just to work. No problem to connect these kinds of tools to Office 365. Okay, enough with the fancy stuff. Let's get a little bit deeper. Another step of program. Is okay. This one. These are the boards, like Raspberry Pi. These are the more advanced boards where you can program and do real stuff, more advanced analytics, more connecting more devices or whatever. This is everyone who worked with Raspberry Pi. Okay, cool stuff. Try it. Okay, so this was the hardware. I will go back. Sorry. I will go back to the basic principle of how you connect these devices to Office 365. You always need some kind of hardware. You see the button, the RFID tag, the beacon, whatever. And on the other hand, you have Office 365 for a cloud service, you want to do that. And you need a gateway to that. And this is provided to different services. Who knows if this and that? Okay, if this and that is a service, I will explain a little bit later, which is capable of connecting one service with another service on the cloud. And they're doing this for years right now. It's an external service. This is Zapier, is doing something similar. And when I started with this session 1.5 years ago, I only can do demonstration based on these services. But I said, wait, maybe 6 or 7 months ahead, Microsoft will provide a similar service that you can use where you can have different cloud service or different services together in a workflow. And you know, we have it right now. It's Office Flow, which is out of beta and right now in production. And we have Power Apps, we have Windows Azure, and we have such protocols like MQTT, which is a special protocol to connect things. This is more technical stuff. But these are 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. These are for our power users. Power Apps for the front end on mobile devices. Flow for all the connecting one with one. And Azure for the more sophisticated stuff for people who want to program. So, and this gets the data, takes them, put them in the workflow, get them front end, push them into Office 365. This is basic stuff. So we need to know what these services are doing, the software services. And if this and that, this is an older slide, because if this and that has rebranded their site 6 months ago and has completely redesigned the setup 2 weeks ago, so it's very dynamic. But the principle is of they're offering channels. I think more than 200 channels. And a channel maybe could be an email. It could be an Office 365 email account or whatever. And whenever something happened in this channel, then it can do something else in another channel. So there's a trigger and there's an action. Very simple, very easy to configure through a website. And this is a basic principle. It's not rocket science. And it's for, especially for power users and for people that work with SharePoint Designer, it's completely easy to do that. But this is something working out of the Microsoft security system. Yes, because it's a third-party vendor, it integrates with Outlook, it integrates with Office 365, you can dig into contacts, you can dig into Slack, you can dig into Yammer. Everything, there are connectors there, but you always have to go to the third-party system. But with Flow, it's all integrated into the Microsoft stuff. And for what I've done, I skipped this. The next, what we now have is Microsoft Flow, where you have also this kind of step-by-step workflows. And if this and that is very cool, it's free to use. It has, I think, more than 300 connectors, so you can connect different things. Your Philips lamp bulb in your office, whatever. Fascinating. Go to this website, ifthisandthat.com, and see what you can do there. But they only can connect one service, have something happened here, then something is done there. Flow is more sophisticated. You can create steps, and you can create your conditions when something is happening, or some condition at that value, then do this, or do that. So it's more sophisticated, and it's running completely in the Office 365 security environment. So this is definitely the tool to go right now to connect through external services. And then we have Power Apps as a front end. I've created this little take the blue pill and take the red pill app, and let's see if it works. Not the tricky part. Okay. And this one. Okay. We switch back to the iPad. Okay, and I've created this small little app here for take the blue pill and take the red pill. And I have created or I've used Skype at the backend here. Skype, I think you're familiar with us, Skype is now offering bots. And there's a bot, it's called if this then that bot. And this means I can connect my Skype to if this then that. So in the flow, something happened here, send a message to Skype, is that what I'm using right now? And through my, to the Power Apps front end, I created this one, take the blue pill, take the red pill, and then I click on that button, I take the blue pill, and it sends a news through if this then that to Skype. And that would work. Ping. Maybe it works. Pong. And I take the red pill, push the button, and it takes the red pill. So this is front end of Power Apps. I used it because I want to use Power Apps, see if it's working, but it could be any other IoT device connected through the stream. And so you can directly get information, not into the what we have seen here on the team side, but directly here as a bot into my my Skype conversation. Also, so this is maybe this is a touch device, but this could be any other device connecting to this to Skype. So also Skype integration, really not a problem to do it on a non-programming level. And this step is also connected to another site. I have here a classical Teams SharePoint site with a, let's see, to clear up first. I have created a SharePoint list. I think it would be great to have SharePoint list. And this SharePoint list is also connected to this Power App through my flow here. And when I press take the blue pill, it sends the news to Skype, but it already also created, and you have to refresh, it creates a new entry in the SharePoint list. And this is done through basic integration into Power Apps into Flow. It's just an action in Flow. When I go to my Flow here and look at the take the red pill, then the stopping point is Power Apps. And when I click on the app, it started a so-called HTTP request. And this is the URL that triggers the channel and if this then that with the special channel and sends it. And the channel is connected to Skype and sends the information to Skype. And the next step we see here, it's create an element. The next one is here, create an element. And this element is very easy to say, go to my SharePoint site, go to the list feedback, take the title from the Power App and send it and create a new app. Just done with 5 minutes, nothing more. And so these are just maybe the tool set you can use to build own applications integrating all this cool stuff. So I show you different things here just to give an idea what's already possible. So there's no programming code in the backend, and with a little bit advanced knowledge, maybe the like of SharePoint Designer, you all can work with this platform maybe within one intense week to get known what's possible and then start creating this one. And this is only version 1.0 what you're seeing right now. Yeah? And already there is lots of things can be done with that. Okay, hi Thomas, what are you doing? Go ahead. So this was Power Apps. Okay, and I can show you, oh, can also have a look in the Power App itself, in the app I've created in Power Apps. This depends on Wi-Fi. What if... Okay. simple app there. It's not very complicated, and I can and then you can start the edit mode and create open up and can build this app. It's just 3 or 4 lines of code where you can create this Power App. I want you to show the Raspberry Teams site. What's interesting is in Teams, we need the information to come in. As you see with this and that, we have this, when something happened here, something is done there. How does Teams know that I have pressed the button? And Teams offering these so-called connectors. Sorry, this is a German interface, but I was happy that it's running, so I didn't take care of the language. I wouldn't broke the audience. And with Teams, that's available for 2 or 3 weeks right now, it comes up with lots of connectors to external sources. And the real cool stuff on cloud service is if you have real good connection, then it works pretty well. So, and it shows you, I will show you in Teams, you have a lot of these connectors. You can connect to Twitter, to RSS feeds, to WonderList, to tons of other Microsoft have done a wonderful job here. And there is one connector that we are using right now here for this one. It's called Incoming Webhook. And this means I can create an URL which hooks into TeamSite and send an information in there. And I have created 2 of these hooks. And the hook is done here. I can create is here. And it says, okay, doorbell conference room. I can put a picture there. And then it creates this URL that you already seen when I showed you the first slide. Through Office 365. This is a webhook and it has a very long URL here. It's created to give all the authentication, all the stuff. So it's a secure entry point into the Teams site. And you just copy and paste this one and put it into your recipe. And then you can send information into the Teams site. Very cool stuff. And what I'm really missing, and now we're back to Alexa or the Echo Dot in the US version. Amazon already offers an if this then that entry point skill for Alexa, so I can trigger if this then that through Alexa here on this device. So next time I can tell Alexa, please send the news to my Skype account, and then it can already send this one to Skype. Currently it's not working in Germany, but it will come in Germany, but I think maybe next few weeks, maybe later, earlier than expected. So even this front end will be connected. This is based on the whole platforms are now built on open standards and trying to get everything inside included, and you can use it to build your own applications and to integrate it. So I think I have 10 more minutes. That looks good because I will show you that. So RFID, oh yeah. So now one, and now we come back to some really serious stuff. I have already mentioned the beacon here. The beacon is similar like the RFID tag, but quite different. Because it's active, it's battery powered, and it's sending out a signal. It's a maybe 120, 140 character long signal. It's an identifier. And when I put it here on this conference room, and it always sends out, I'm number 123. And if I have an app that can read this one through Bluetooth and say, oh, 123, this is conference room, ooh, oh. And so it can recognize the location and send the location information to your device. This sounds pretty crazy. You can do some cool stuff with beacons. You know when you're coming into this meeting room or a meeting room with some colleagues and you set up your PCs, you set up the big monitor, you start a Skype call, you put the sign on the front door of room occupied, you have to do manually. There's an option, and let me see if it works here. You can do it automatically. This is the Collaborate Cube. This was a demo at the CeBIT Fair in Hannover in March. And this was a conference room set up for demo purposes. They had 1, 2, 3 surfaces there, 2 big monitors. And this was the red surface, the blue surface, and the green surface. And now let's go ahead. Let's go to the demo here. This is Uwe who do all the demonstration. They have a sign there which says, okay, this is the room and who is in the room. They have the green lights there and stop. And they have an app. They need the app for demo purposes, but think about it. This is my smartphone with Skype for Business online. I'm logged into Skype for Business, maybe in 2 or 3 months. So, and this was my smartphone. I was logged in to the systems and just entering the conference room with my smartphone. We have 2 other colleagues there, one on the blue phone and one on the green phone. And when we started to enter this one, you see, automatically, the room recognized that I was entering the room. Michael, Uwe, and Ahmed were entering the room. It was automatically sent to the boards. They started automatically a Skype for Business session for us. The sign outside was set on red, and the participant was also displayed on the front. And on all the laptops were started a Skype for Business session. So I was asked to go with my red phone to the red surface, and the other was asked to go to their phone. So for each individual person coming into the room was set up a Skype for Business entry point on the laptops. And this is the magic. This is Aruba. It's a little bit bigger. This is the beacon. And the whole staff is working on the beacon, because when we enter with our phones, the beacon recognizes, oh, Mike is entering the room. And then in the backend starts a big service. They can look at my Outlook calendar, who's in my meeting right now, what's my name, what is the meeting room, and can start the Skype for Business. It does everything in the backend. Nothing to do more than just enter the room without touching, small, whatever. And, well, this works pretty cool. And when we left the room, Uwe collected all the phones, we left the room. And then, of course, everything was cleaned up. The Skype for Business session was closed. The room was set on green. And all the documents we have created were stored on a Skype, on Office 365 set. Done. This is IoT in real life, just based on this small, single iBeacon technology. And it's interesting, in Berlin, I'm talking to several startups, and there are several startups working on this beacon technology. And when I ask them, hey, what are you doing with this beacon technology? And lots of people are like, we're doing conference automation, conference room automation. This is one use case for this one. And I think it's very impressive. And another one for team, maybe, oh, let me see. Okay, you have 10 minutes. Maybe I can say, we'll run a little bit of time. But another one, especially what maybe, oh, wait, so let's see. Maybe you know this one. Virtual presence, I see.
Greetings, friends. Greetings, wherever the hell you are. I am a mobile virtual presence device.
Mobile virtual presence device. Looks very funny in movies, okay. But when I look at YouTube, see what's available for mobile virtual presence devices, I found this TED session from 2000.
So I'd like to welcome you to the TED stage, the man behind those revelations, Ed Snowden. Ed is in a remote location somewhere in Russia, controlling this bot with, from his laptop. So he can see what the bot can see. Ed, welcome to the TED stage. What can you see, as a matter of fact?
I can see everyone. This is amazing.
So this is March 2014, yeah? So maybe you have missed this technology, but it's already there, virtual present devices. So that may be the next version of Skype for business meetings. It gives you lots of more flexibility because from remote location you can walk to rooms or whatever. And even Microsoft is using it because I found another one from Microsoft.
From Microsoft, and I'm beaming in from Silicon Valley, California. Use of the beam has enabled me to stay connected with my team without.
Okay, so this may be the next device, or it's already available. And Microsoft Berlin is doing a half-year event called Explained, and the last one was in October, and they had one of these devices on location there, running through the rooms and. That was very, very creepy because it depends on wireless LAN and if you have not good wireless connection, even IoT device connection. I think a cloud service without good Wi-Fi isn't the future. So this is something you maybe see, as we already said, talk about new user interfaces and maybe, okay. Give me one more. I would show you one more stuff about virtual reality. When you dig, what can you do with 3D? Not only playing games, but I will show you how a developer can explore code. This is a developer who has a 3D Vive headset on it, has a handheld device, and is digging into his code. He's not seeing it on the regular monitor, line by line, but he can really dig into his code, can see, okay, this is connected with that one, and gives you a complete new insight on his code, maybe on connections. Does it have something to do with Office 365? So that's my final slide. I will show you. Maybe you've already seen this one here, because this is the office graph. And imagine you have a 3D device on your head. You have this device, and you are digging into the office graph. Just going into your whole company with all this stuff and digging into the graph. Not only on the surface like that, but you really can dig into this, into a 3D room based on your whole office graph, on your whole information in your company. This is not future 2040. I think this will be available maybe in 3 years. Completely different ways you will see how we work with technology. So it's 10:11:15. I will pray for the demo gods that everything's worked fine here. Thank you for coming. I really appreciate it because there were very interesting other speakers per here. I hope you have got some ideas, and so I will be here for the next 2 days. So if you have any questions, please ask, and enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you very much.